Hi all, and welcome to part 3 and the last of this mini-series. I may do some follow-ups on the subject in the future, but this part concludes our little canon game. Before we start, I need to correct one small thing from the last video. The math around gravity was wrong. Distance traveled over time is acceleration times time squared divided by 2. Seeing I forgot the divide by 2, halving the gravity worked around the issue. I've corrected the mistake in the GitHub repository. The other noteworthy thing that was raised by one of my viewers is something I take for granted nowadays. You should never scale physics objects. The most efficient collision shape is the sphere. Detecting a collision between two spheres is super easy. You calculate the distance between the centers of the two spheres. If this distance is less than the combined radiuses of the spheres, we're colliding. If the sphere was scaled, especially with different scale factors for each axis, this would not work. Similar issues exist for the other collision shapes that are all represented by mathematical formulas that don't react well when we're trying to apply scaling. Bottom line, do not scale your physics objects. Let's go back to our project. We're going to visualize which collisions are contributing to our score. For that, we need to know the location of the object that resulted in our score increasing. We'll be sending that information along with our signal, so we're adding an at parameter. And then we add the global transform's origin when we emit this signal. I'm also getting rid of our print statement that we no longer need. With our new parameter, we need to update our UI script as well. We'll be instantiating a scene at this location that will show our score, so in order to identify that scene, we need an export variable. We'll be creating that scene in a minute, and it will be a 2D scene. If we have a score scene, we're going to instantiate this scene when we score. Then we tell our new scene the score it will be displaying. Now we need to position our scene, and for this we need to know the 2D location for our at location. For this we get our viewport. Then we get the viewport's active camera, and we call the camera's unprojectPosition function. Weird name, I know. We need to add our new scene to our UI scene, which we should do before setting the position. Now we create a new scene and turn it into a 2D scene. We'll call our root node score. We add a label to actually show our score. We'll give it a default value of 0 and make sure that it is nicely centered on our label. We'll also assign our custom font. Next, we'll resize our label to be a nice square, and we're going to center it on our root node. We'll quickly save the scene and add a script to it. Now we add our setScore function to populate our label with our score. Now we can go back to our UI scene and select the scene we just created so it is instanced. Going back to our score scene, we are going to add an animation player. We add a new animation to our animation player. Then we tick the autoplay icon to make sure this animation plays when the scene is instantiated and add it to our UI scene. We'll change the animation to be 3 seconds long, and zoom in on that a little. The first thing we're going to do is add a call method track, so we can call our cleanup at the end. We often do this with a lifetime timer, but seeing we're going to be animating our scene anyway, we can also do this here. We right-click at the end of our timeline and insert a new key. Now we select our queueFree method to free our scene. Going back to our 2D editor, with the label selected, we are going to create our first keyframe by clicking the key icon next to our position. Make sure your timeline is at the start. We are going to make this a Bezier track, so we get smooth transitions. We select the 1 second mark on our timeline and move our label into position. Then we press the icon again to create a keyframe. At the 2 second mark, we move it up some more. And finally, at the 3 second mark, we give it its final position. When we play this, we see our score move along our path, but it's very rough. Let's give us some space to work with in the timeline. And click on the little curve icon to edit our position curve. Now we can use our Bezier handles to create a nice flowing movement line. Doing the same for our Y position, I do get into trouble that I can't scroll this interface very well. If someone can tell me if there is a trick to this, please leave a comment. We can see that's better. Not perfect, but I don't want to spend more time on this in this video. Next, we're going to add a scale track into our scene. I'm starting at the just over half a second mark, where I want our shape to be scaled normally. And then at the start of our timeline, I scale it to 0. Then at the 2 second mark, I want another keyframe where the scale is still 1. And at the end of our timeline, I want it scaled back to 0. Now when we play, we see our score pop into existence, float up, and disappear. Now we want our block to be destructible. We already made it disappear when the block is destroyed. We want some small blocks to take its place. We again create a new scene, but this will be a 3D scene. We'll call the root node Destructed Blocks. We'll create our first block just like before. We start with a rigid body at the base. Then we add a mesh instance with a cube mesh. We size this so 8 pieces fit into our original shape. We also give it the material our original block uses. We complete it with a matching collision shape. We move our first block into position. We'll save our scene at this point, but in this case, I'm not saving our block into a subscene. That felt like overkill. Now we duplicate our block and move the second block into position. We repeat this 6 more times. Now these blocks no longer play a part in our scoring, so we're not going to assign our script to them, but we do need a script for our scene. In this script, we're creating a function that will copy the current velocity of the block being destructed to our 8 mini blocks. We can simply loop through our child elements to apply these. Going back to our script on our destructible object, we're going to add an export variable so we can identify our new scene. Here it is important that we can use different destructed scenes for different objects. Now, when we break our block, we can instance this new scene. We add this as a child scene of our current scene's parent. We copy our object's global transform to our new scene's global transform to position it. And we call our copy velocity function. To link it all up, we'll select our subscene. Now, when we hit our front block, with sufficient force, we can see we scored 100 points and we see our block break into 8 smaller blocks. If we hit our second block, we can see we also break that one. As you can see, I've duplicated our blocks a few more times to create a more complex structure to knock down. I want to add a different shape for us to see how we can reuse what we've created so far very quickly. So we start with a new scene, where we change the root node to a rigid body. We call this triangle. As before, we add a mesh instance. This time we'll use a prism. Let's save our scene so we can add it to our main scene and check our size. I'm going to rotate it in our subscene as we'll likely always use it in this orientation. That looks better, but I want it to be less tall. Yeah. One unit looks good. We assign the same material as we've used for our blocks. Now we don't have a triangle collision shape, so with our mesh instance selected, this time we're going to use create trimesh collision sibling. This will create our collision shape for us and create a polygon-based collision object for it. Now why did we not do this before? And why don't we do this all the time? It's so easy. Well, it comes back to what we talked about at the start. Mesh-based collision shapes take far more effort to test collisions against. If we can use spheres or boxes, use spheres or boxes, each and every time. Interestingly enough, our collision shape did not get the orientation copied, so we need to rotate it to match. Now we can add the same script we used for our blocks to our triangle scene. Going back to our main scene, we can position our triangle properly. Remember, it needs to fit snugly. We'll also create a second triangle by duplicating a node. We want our triangles to break apart too. Before implementing this, let's rename the script on our destructed block scene to just destructed.gd. Always close scenes using a script before renaming it. We create a new scene and rename its root node to destructed triangle. We save our scene and attach our destructed script to it. Now we repeat the steps we did for our blocks, but now with triangles. We create our rigid body, we add a mesh instance and shape to it, rotate it, and use our mesh menu to create our sibling collision shape. We then move it into position. And we duplicate it a couple of times and position it. I'm just skipping this part. Let's also set our material to all our mesh instances. Yes, I know I can set the material on the mesh itself, and seeing where we're using the mesh for each instance, that will be a single action. Habits don't die easy. Both are good options. Now we can hook up our destructed scene to our triangle scene. We also need to ensure that our contact monitor is turned on, and we set our contact report to 10. And we hook up our body entered signal to our existing method in our script, so we react to other objects hitting us. We got lucky on our first shot. It took a while before everything caved in, but our first triangle broke into parts in the end. So far, we've created objects that are fully controlled by our physics engine. We only control the initial speed of our cannonball. To round off, we're going to implement an explosive, and in doing so, we'll look at a few new parts of the physics engine. We start with a new scene and change the type to a rigid body, so that it does interact with the rest of the scene. We'll add a mesh instance with a cube. This will stand in for our explosive. With the material, we turn it into a big red cube. We also need a collision shape. Now we add our explosive into our scene. Again, we need to place it precisely. Back in our subscene, we'll add a script to our root node. The collision shape controls our rigid body just like with our blocks, but we can't use it to trigger our explosive. Remember, our explosive will be resting on the floor, so it will be colliding with the floor. Things can get pretty tricky. We're going to trigger our explosive in a different way. We are going to use an area node. An area node allows us to detect things going on inside of the area, but it doesn't interact with anything. An area can be used to affect the gravity settings within, but we won't be covering that today. So, we add an area node and call it our trigger, as this area will trigger the explosion. Then we add a collision shape that gives a shape to our area. Again, this doesn't collide with anything. We resize our box so it is slightly larger than our box, and move it upwards so we don't detect anything underneath our box. Now we can hook up our body entered signal so we can react on another object entering our area. We only want to explode once, as we won't remove ourselves right away, so we add a variable for this. If we weren't triggered yet, we'll set our variable to true. At the end, for now, we'll queue free our object. When our box explodes, this needs to have an effect on all objects that are nearby. We're going to implement that in the space above, but how do we find out which objects are close enough? Well, we're going to use another area. We call this effect range. We'll add a sphere collision shape to it. Any object within this sphere when we explode will be affected by our explosion. We don't need to hook up any signals. Godot will detect when objects enter and leave our area and remembers which objects are currently within our area's collision shape. We can simply loop through the objects within our area by calling getOverlappingBodies on our area. Our explosive is also inside of its own area, so we ignore that. Else, if our body is a rigid body, and right now it will be, we determine a direction vector by subtracting the body's position from our own. We'll define a variable with which we can set the strength with which we affect our objects. Now we apply an impulse on each body using the normalized direction vector and multiplying it by our impulse strength. To keep things easy, we just apply the impulse to the center of our body. Applying an impulse on a physics body basically applies a momentary force to the object to push it into that direction. If it is applied off-center, it will also result in a rotation of the object. I'm being over-careful here, but we'll see eventually that we'll hit our box and it will push all the objects around it outwards. In the final version, I've also added a particle effect for an explosion. We won't handle that part here because it's an entirely different subject. You can find the source code for it on GitHub. This is only the tip of the iceberg as far as the physics engine is concerned. Hopefully you have enjoyed this small introduction. I will be looking at kinematic bodies in the near future and may do some advanced physics tutorials. Let me know what you guys would like to know more about. If you found this video useful, please consider liking the video. Until next time!